Okay, so today we're going to cover six of the video lectures. However, four of these are, you know, can be gone through fairly quickly. So we will go through those fairly quickly. So it should take the same amount of time, maybe 35, 40 minutes. But we want to basically cover the logical unit, okay? So the first one is Introduction to Software Engineering. So software engineering is, you know, let's just quickly, so there is a lot of description here, you can go through that. But sort of the kind of point that I want to highlight is that in general, the software that you're going to design, you know, probably your project is going to be the first such software that you will design. It will typically be of large size, have complex functionalities, will hopefully be used by many people and will also be developed by many people, and it requires significant time and effort. So, you know, this is the important point, that large coordinated effort is required to build, operate and maintain software. And I think your project is the first such instance of that. And what we're going to see in the next few slides is some things that we have, you know, repeatedly said during the course, but it's now documented there, and things that we expect you to follow as you are going about with your project. Okay, so in your project, we expect you to develop a piece of software which is doing something complex, has a non-trivial effort involved. So for this purpose, these are some of the metrics that are used to understand how complex a software has become. So one is this lines of code, the other is function points, and you know, depending on lines of code or number of function points, there are other metrics also that characterize the complexity of a software. But lines of code is often very commonly used, and we say lines of non-comment code, so you don't count the comments as lines of code. So that kind of gives you a typical idea. So we expect your project to be around, you know, maybe 1,000 lines of code, 1,000 lines of non-comment code written properly. And the effort is often measured in terms of how much effort was put in by a person. If that person was working alone, how many months would that person take? So it's person months. So two persons working for 1 month is 2%. One person working for 2 months is also 2% months. And this involves the, when we try to quantify the effort, we take the whole thing into account. You know, it's not just writing the piece of code, but testing, documentation, ensuring that all the, you know, error handling is done properly, all diagnostic messages are given out properly, all of that. And this is kind of, you know, 15 to 25 lines of code per day would, I think, be considered, you know, bare minimum that you, if you're working in a professional environment. So as I said, we expect around 1,000 lines of code for your project. The amount of effort is three or four of you working over a period of 1 month, but of course not working full time. So you're probably working, you know, whatever, 1 hour a day, something like that. Okay, so this is the usual life cycle. This is what we have recommended you to follow for your project. So there's a conceptualization aspect, detailing all functional requirements. So this is kind of what we have asked you to submit by Sunday, at least the conceptualization, at least some detail of the functional requirements, if not all details. Then you design the system, you develop the software, and then you've also got to do testing and quality assurance. And finally, you know, just because you have developed a software doesn't mean that it's okay. It has to be accepted by the client for whomever you wrote the software. In the case of your project, by us. If you've written your project, doesn't mean your job is over. You have to do something which makes us accept it. And then, of course, you know, there is maintenance. You know, once you write a software and deploy it, you know, maintenance for it is going to be an ongoing process. Maintenance includes gathering bugs. So how many of you, I mean, all of you have been using code blocks and the C compiler. So have you encountered any bug with the compiler, the G++ compiler, which is running at the back end? Have you seen an instance where it is doing something that it is not supposed to do? Nobody? So the point I'm trying to say is that I have personally not encountered any bug in the GCC compiler, G++ compiler. However, I've read papers which report about bugs in this compiler, and then there are websites which report about bugs. So it's a fairly robust piece of software developed over so many years by so many users, but still that has bugs. You know, and so to guarantee that a piece of software has absolutely zero bugs is a fairly tall claim of tall order. I mean, things which have been tested, developed, used for so many years, so many decades actually, still have bugs. However, as time goes on, the rate of bugs keeps decreasing and the software becomes even more and more reliable. So at least for your project, we would like you to do some corner case stress testing to make sure that, you know, some obvious bugs have been taken care of. But still, there will probably be bugs present. And for those who are contesting for the AP grade, I mean, certainly your code will be tested for lots of corner cases to expose bugs in the code. And then, of course, you could enhance the functionality of the code. I mean, you might have designed something today, and then there is demand for enhancing the functionality. And you could also, you might also want to interface it to other software applications which are coming up. So this typically constitutes a very large percentage, you know, up to 80% of the total cost of a software's entire life cycle. And this sort of emphasizes the fact that we must write, or we must try to write, very high quality software in the first place. Okay. So, you know, I mean, some very grave consequences of software errors, just completely programming errors, that have happened was that around 15 years back, there was an Ariane 5 rocket which was launched to go to space, and it just exploded a few minutes into its takeoff. And this was because there were sensors which were picking up, you know, some acceleration data from the rocket as it was moving, and there was a bug in the conversion of the data from one metric system to another metric system. And because of that bug, and of course the software was tested through a lot of things, and it was certified as okay, but there was that corner case bug, and that got triggered, and the entire rocket just exploded. Right. So there are similarly cases of when you go to a hospital, and for example, have any of you seen a CT machine, CT scan machine, or at least a picture of a CT scan machine? Yeah, so it's basically, you know, a machine through which the patient's body goes through, and X-rays are passed, and you take a lot of images. So it basically shows you as the body would appear if you were to cut a section through the body, without, of course, cutting the body. But this is actually exposing the patient to a lot of X-rays. And so there is software which is controlling how much of X-rays are pumped into the patient's body as the patient's body is passing through an X-ray machine. And bugs in that software have actually caused some patients to be overexposed to X-rays, which have caused, you know, other kinds of complications in there. So you know, the more we become dependent on software, the more it's important to write high quality software. And of course, when you're writing software, coding style is important. There are recommended coding styles. You know, variable names should be written in a certain way, type name should be written in a certain way, function name should be written in a certain way, indentation should be done in a certain way. This is to ensure that it is readable, understandable, others can pick up your code and modify it if needed. And there are several references which are there which you can look up. Okay? So, are there any questions about this? I mean, this is more like what good programmers should do, and we expect all of you to be at least moving in that direction. And so, we expect you to keep these in mind. So, I mean, as I said, you know, a very large percentage of the cost of developing a software actually goes in maintaining it. And if you can write code which is good quality, make sure that bugs are few, you actually cut down that significant part of the cost. Right. Okay, so if there are no doubts about this, let's move on to the next topic. You know, our first glimpse of what is called object-oriented programming, and we're going to start off with structures. For those of you who have gone through the video lectures, of course, you know, this should be fairly straightforward, but for those of you who haven't, let me just say that, you know, here we are trying to design a book checkout return claim management system of a small library. Like in our central library, when you go, you say, I want to issue a book, I want to claim a book, or I want to return a book. So there are three kinds of operations that we'll define: checking out a book, claiming a book, and returning a book. Checking out means you give a book and then the book is issued to you, right? And so in this case, a patron can check up to three books at any time. Claiming a book means if I've not already checked out three books, and if I want a book and that book is currently with somebody, I can place a claim for that. So when the book is returned, I'm going to get it. And returning a book is, of course, returning. So how do we go about writing code for such a library management system? So one option, the bad option, the non-recommended option, is to just jump into writing the code and then keep adding variables, arrays, functions as and when you need. So for each book, as you'll realize, there are lots of information that you want to keep. You know, some title and authors, these would be character arrays, price, accession number, checkout status, claimant's ID, and so on. So what one, and similarly for each patron, there are lots of, you know, things that one might want to remember: name, address, number of books checked out, and so on. So what one could do is that if the library has 1,000 books, it's a very small library, so then I could say that, well, I'm going to keep a 1,000 sized array where each element of the array is a string or a character array representing the title of a book. So there are 1,000 books, so these are 1,000 sized arrays. Each element of the array is going to store information about a book. So I could have an array of character arrays storing the book title, an array of another array of character arrays storing the author's names, an array of doubles storing the prices of the different books, and so on, right? But I mean, you'll appreciate that this is not a natural way to represent the information, right? The information about the same book, I'm splitting it across into six different arrays. This is probably not a very desirable way to do it. And in particular, if I ask you to do the following, if I can say that, can you find the claimant for the book with some accession number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, then what would you have to do? You would have to go and look up the accession number array, and then you have to go and search that array to find out where 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is. And then you have to pick up that index where you found out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So suppose that is the fifth index. So then you would know that, well, the fifth book is the one with accession number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now you'll have to go to the claimant array and look up what the fifth entry there is. It is a very convoluted way of figuring out who's the claimant for a book with accession number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we don't want to do that. So what we'd like to do is, we'd like to group all the information about a book together into a book entity, okay? So all of it, name, title, author's name, who has claimed it, what is its price, everything. We'd like to put together into one coherent entity, and then we'd like to have an array of these entities. So then, if I want you to find out who's the claimant of book with accession number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I'll just search through this array, and each element in this array is this entire entity containing all information about a book. So the moment I reach an entity whose accession number matches 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, for that same entity, I will just read off the claimant information. So if we could group things together, then we could do this in this much nicer way. And similarly, I could group all information about a patron into one patron entity and keep an array of these patron entities, right? So this would be a more logical, more natural way to program. And actually, this provides us some facilities to do this. So for example, it provides us this facility called a structure. So you say struct, then you give a name for the structure. And so this is a structure book, which can have all of these things related to a book, right? So as we will see shortly, I can actually define a variable of type book. And what that variable represents is this entire collection of information. That variable will have something called a title, that variable will have something called authors, it will have something called price, and so on, right? So by grouping things together, we are saying that let's put everything that logically appears coherent, that is related to each other for purposes of our programming assignment, for programming task, let's put them together into one entity and then we can deal with these entities. So this, I believe, will be very important for your projects. You know, when you're doing your projects, you would want to group information, related information together, and so structure should be important. So that struct is a C++ keyword, and book, whatever I've said here, is the name of the structure type. This is just like integer, character, data, just like the names of other types. So essentially now we are defining our own types rather than depending only on the types provided by the C++ standard. And then, you know, these different things, title, authors, price, these are called members of the structure book. And members can be arrays as well as variables. So for example, these members are variables, these two members are arrays. And for a particular member, the name that we give to that member is called the member name, and the type is the member type. So it's like declaring variables within a structure, and then I'm going to declare variables of this structure type, right? So I'm grouping things together and then saying, let's take this whole as one logical entity, and we can then declare variables, arrays, whatever we want to. So how do I declare a variable of type book? You know, just like the way we would declare a variable of type int, we say book in place of int, and then we give the name of the variables, just like I would use int, my int, your int, whatever. Similarly for array, just like for integer, I would say int roll numbers 1000, so here I can say book library shelf 1000. So this name book that we have used along with this struct, this becomes the name of a type, just like integer, character, double, whatever. So this is an array of 1000 elements, where each element in this array is an object of type book. So each element in the array has so many information pieces along with it. Each element in this array is this composite thing, inside which there are so many other things, right? Because we want to access an element in the array and we want to say that is book number 5. And associated with book number 5, there is so much information. So we want all of that to be present in that entity itself. Okay. So similarly for patterns, I could define a structure. Basically, I'm grouping together all the relevant information of a pattern together. Okay. So this is basically, you know, sort of in one slide, what we mean by object-oriented programming, that when you're given a programming task, you first identify these entities, which could be physical entities like a pattern or a book, or they could even be conceptual entities, you know, like a rectangle or a geometric object or, you know, whatever you're trying to program about. So you identify these entities that are involved in the working of the system. So these entities are also called objects. That's where the name object-oriented programming comes about. And then you think of the relations between these entities. So the overall functionality of the system can be thought of as interactions between these entities and operations on these entities, right? So a pattern will come and check out a book. A book will get claimed by another pattern, right? So these are relations, interactions between entities. And you also abstract away or hide the details that are not necessary to be exposed for a particular operation, right? So for example, I mean, we will see examples where, you know, when I'm doing a particular maybe return operation, I don't need to expose some of the details. So I want to abstract or hide them away. And of course, you know, as I'm building these entities and their interactions, this allows me to build the overall system functionality in a modular, incremental way. Okay, and we expect all of you to do your projects in this way. They're not just one monolithic piece of code, but identify the entities, how they interact, and program your project so that it captures that, it reflects that interaction between entities. So this is what object-oriented programming is about. So the object contains information about, you know, one logical coherent entity. So it can have information which is relatively fixed, usually doesn't change as objects interact. For example, the name of a pattern or title of a book. Or it could also have information that changes as objects interact. So for example, the checkout status of a book. You know, the moment a pattern checks out a book, that information changes. And of course, an object must have unambiguous, well-defined boundaries. It's not that at some point of time you want to store something in the object and at some other point of time you don't want to store that as part of the object. It must have completely well-defined boundaries. You should understand very clearly what information is within the object, what information is within another object, what is the interaction about, right? So this actually, I mean, writing something in an object-oriented way also forces you to think in a structured and disciplined way. So this is certainly the preferred way to go about programming. Interactions between any two objects should ideally happen through very well-defined cases. You know, as in the textbook, Professor Abhiram Ranade's textbook, he says that when you're looking at a television, right, there is a lot of complicated electronic circuitry inside the television. But when you're interacting with the television, you just have a remote in your hand, you have a few operations that you can do, and that is all by which you can interact with the television. Inside, a lot of stuff is happening. So when you're trying to change a channel, you don't go inside and change a capacitance and change a resistance and change an inductance to change a channel. You just press a switch, and internally a lot of things are happening. Right? So that is what we mean by well-defined interfaces. Pressing that switch has a well-defined function. It is meant to change a channel and only change a channel. You take that action and inside, behind the scenes, a lot of stuff is happening. But that is not your concern. Right? You have hidden away that information, presented well-defined interfaces, and all interaction should happen through those interfaces. So this hiding of information is also called abstraction or data encapsulation. So we will cover this later in the course. So are there any doubts about what we just said? This is a very simple idea of how you group related information together, and that's kind of the foundation stone of object-oriented programming. No questions? Good. So let's see some usages of this. So here is our simple library example that we just saw. Here is the structure book and the structure patron. They have different kinds of members. And as we said, we can declare, you know, an array called library shelf, which has 1,000 books in it, and an array called library patrons, which has 200 patrons in it. It's a fairly small library. You know, since this structure book has so many things inside it, the question is, if I want to find out the price of a book, what should I do? You know, I may know that this is the fifth book in the array library shelf, but then how do I go and find out the price of the book or whatever, the accession number of the book? So C++ actually provides this dot operator for this purpose. So once you have a variable my choice, let us say, of this type book. So my choice is a variable of type book. So basically this variable has all of this information, title, authors, price, accession number and everything in it. So now if I want to access a specific member, I use this dot operator. So I say my choice dot price. This accesses the member named price of the object my choice. Okay, so very convenient way of representing. Just put a dot and then you can go inside that structure and access a particular member. And once you've put the dot and you know, sort of constructed this my choice dot price, this is like any other variable in a program. Because you are now accessing this member inside the structure, and that member is a double typed member. So you can use it like any other double typed member. So for example, I could read in my choice dot price, I could add 20 to my choice dot price, I could print out my choice dot price. It's just like any other double valued member, double valued variable, right? Similarly, I could access the name member, which is actually a character array, by just saying current patron dot name, right? So this dot allows me to go inside the structure and access any particular member by the name of that member. So I could write code like if current patron dot name, which is referring to a character array, and if the first element in that character array is capital S, then I'm going to print out that name. So this is just like using any other character array, right? So the moment I say current patron, it is referring to that object which has all of that information. Dot name means I've gone inside that and accessed that particular member name, which is a character array, and now I can use it just like any other character array. Fine, so it's a very convenient way of accessing members, of grouping related information together and then accessing the relevant information. How do I initialize structures? So this is how we might want to initialize integers or characters. Just say equal and provide the value. So in structures also we do pretty much the same thing, except that, you know, when I'm trying to initialize a structure, I have to specify a value for each of these members. So I say current patron is a variable of type patron. It is initialized to within braces, you give the values for each of these members in exactly the same sequence in which they have been defined over here. So the first is the initial value for name, the second is the initial value for address, the third is the unique ID, the fourth is the number of books checked out, the fifth is the initial value for claimed book accession number. Right? So it's pretty much the same, and sort of logically, if I'm trying to initialize a group of things, I must specify the initial values of everything there. So I have to specify it in the same order. That is important. Right? If you specify IIT Bombay India first and Shashidev next, then of current pattern dot name will get set to IIT Bombay India. Right? The computer doesn't know that IIT Bombay India doesn't look like a name. Whatever value you give there, it will get initialized to that. Yeah, so that's what I just said. And then I could even copy one structure to another. So for example, here is an example of copying integers. So I set I to 27 and then copy I to j. So now j gets the value 27. So I could do a similar thing. So I could say current pattern is whatever we initialized earlier. And then I could say previous pattern is assigned current pattern. You know, just like we would assign one variable to another of integer or character type, we can do exactly the same thing with these user defined types. Right? And what this will do is, you know, so current pattern is an object which has lots of members, previous pattern is also an object which has lots of members. So this assignment will copy the value of each member of current pattern to the corresponding member of previous pattern. So you'll basically get an exact copy of the object on the right hand side of the assignment statement. Right? So this is also natural, this is to be expected. When I'm copying, all the members here should get copied to all the members there. So the values of all these members will be copied there. So is that clear, the dot operator? So now let's look at a programming example with whatever we have learned. So this is the library management system again. So what we're going to do is, we have this structure book, and we have defined an array called library shelf, which has 1,000 books. And let us say to begin with, we will say the checkout status of every book is false, and the claimant ID, which is if somebody has claimed this book, is initialized to -1. Let's say that initially when we start off the system, when we run our program, initially every object of library shelf has these members initialized appropriately, the title, author, price and accession number of the book, but these two are initialized to false and -1. And then we have an array library patrons of patrons. Let's say there are 200 patrons, and each such patron of course have all of these members. And once again, we will assume that when we start off, num books checked out for each patron is set to 0, and the claimed books accession number is set to -1. This is how we are starting off the system. And name, address, unique ID are whatever initialized according to the patron's details. Now, we want to write a C++ function for checking out a book. Okay. So let us say there is a variable current patron which denotes a patron who wants to check out a book, and the book that she wants to check out is in this variable current book. So current patron is of type patron, current book is of type book, and current patron wants to check out current book. So this is what we'll have to do. So we said that each patron is allowed to check out 3 books. So we have to first check if the patron has already checked out 3 books. If so, we will say you can't check out any more books. Otherwise, we have to check if the current book has already been checked out. If so, then we have to print an appropriate message. Otherwise, we have to see if the current book has not been checked out, but if it has been claimed by somebody already, then we cannot issue it. So then we'll have to print an appropriate message. And if the current book is not checked out and not already claimed, then we can issue this book. So in that case, we will increment the value of the num books checked out member of current patron, because the current patron will now have one more book issued to her, and will update the checkout status of current book to true, because now this book is being checked out. Fine. And of course, we want these changes to these members to persist after the current book has been checked out. So basically, we will need to have functions to which we'll have to pass parameters by reference, so that even if the function returns, the members of the corresponding current book and current patron would stay updated, right? So here is how it might look like. So in the main function, I'm saying check out books, library. So the ith patron is checking out the jth book. And here is check out book to which I've passed these two parameters by reference. And what do I do in the code for checking out a book? I first check if the numbooks checked out member of current pattern is less than 3. Okay, which means if the current pattern has not already checked out 3 books, then I'll allow the current pattern to check out a book. Otherwise, I'll say that, you know, sorry, you've already checked out too many books. Okay, so what do we do here? How do we check out a book? So if the number of books checked out is less than 3, we'll have to check if the book has already been checked out by somebody. So if the checkout status of the book is true, then it means the book is already with somebody. So then we can say that, well, sorry, this book is already checked out. So you can't check this book out, right? Otherwise, we have to do something else. What do? We check whether this current book is already being claimed by somebody, right? So this claimant ID is a member of the current book object. And if this is not -1, then it has the ID of a claimant. So if current book's claimant ID is not -1, it means somebody has already claimed this book. It could be that this current pattern itself has claimed this book. So we'll also check that if the claimant ID is not -1, and if the current pattern's ID is not the claimant ID, which means that somebody is claiming this book and it is not the current pattern, then we'll have to say that there is already a pending claim, you can't get it now. Otherwise, we can allow the pattern to check out the book, right? So we'll just set the checkout status member of current book to true, increment numbooks checked out of current pattern by 1. So notice that I'm, you know, once I use the dot operator and have access to the members of the structure, I'm using them just like variables. Right? That's the whole purpose of using the dot operator. And then if the current book's claimant ID is the patron's unique ID, which means the patron had actually claimed this book. So the current book's claimant ID is the same as the patron's ID. Then we will set, now that the book is being issued to the patron, we will set the claimant ID of the book to -1, and we'll set the claimed book's accession number of the current patron to -1. So note that I'm actually updating different members of current pattern and current book in the process of checking out a book, right? Some information is stored within the current pattern because it logically makes sense to belong there. Claimed book accession number is something that is particular to this pattern, so it's stored with the pattern. Claimant ID is something that is specific to the book, so it's stored with the book. Checkout status is specific to the book. Numbooks checked out is specific to the pattern. So I've grouped this information together, and then the checkout function is updating the appropriate things, appropriate members of the appropriate objects. Okay? So, yeah, and since we pass the parameters by reference, so whatever changes we are doing here are really changes happening in the variables, the objects and the arrays that were passed from the main function. So they're going to stay even after the function returns. Is this fine? So now we will just see the last part of today's lecture, which is how to implement the checkout and return functionality. So checkout we just saw, claim and return. Okay. So I want to claim a book. A current pattern wants to claim a current book. Okay. So what should we do? I mean, so this is kind of the design phase where you're saying that, well, I want to implement claiming of a book by a pattern. So what is it that I have to do? So I have to sort of write it down. You know, what is the kind of pseudocode or algorithm that I write it down? And then I go ahead and implement it. Right? So I have to check if the current pattern has already checked out 3 books or already has a pending claim. So if she has already checked out 3 books, then of course no question of putting another claim. And if she already has a pending claim, first that claim should get cleared, then she can put another claim. So if so, we'll print an appropriate message and return. Otherwise, we'll have to check if the current book is not already checked out by anybody, and if the pattern is trying to claim this book. So if the book is not already checked out, it's in the library and the pattern wants to claim this book. I mean, why claim? The pattern can just check out this book. It's there in the library, right? So we can print the appropriate message that please check out. There's no need to claim. Otherwise, if the current book is not already claimed by a different pattern, then if the current book is already claimed by a different pattern, we cannot allow another claim on that same book. You know, this simple library allows only one claim on a book. But if the current book is not already claimed by a different pattern, then I'll have to place the claim of current pattern on current book. So how do I do that? I store the ID of the patron in the claimant ID of the book. So once again, say I'm updating different members of the different objects to store the relevant information within the relevant object boundaries. Right? I don't want to mix them up. The claimant ID of the patron is being the ID of the patron is being stored in the claimant ID of the book, and the accession number of the book is being stored in the claimed book's accession number of the patron. Right? So information that is specific to a patron will stay within the patron's structure. Information that's specific to a book will stay within the book structure. Okay, so how do we claim a book? So this is what we just said. If the patron has already checked out 3 books, or if the patron already has made a claim to another book, so if the claim book accession number is not -1, which means the current patron has already claimed some other book, then we say that you can't claim any further book. Otherwise, if the book has not already been checked out, if the book is in the library, so if the checkout status of the book is false, then we say that it's not yet checked out, so there's no need to claim, you can check out the book straight away. Right? Otherwise, if this book is already being claimed by somebody and that somebody is not the same as current patron, then we have to say that this book is already being claimed by a different patron. You cannot claim it. So once again, notice that I'm accessing different members of different structures. Basically, I want to access that information, but depending on which object boundary it is in, I have to use the appropriate object. And then finally, if I'm trying to claim the book, I set the current book's accession number to the claimed book accession number of patron. I set the current patron's ID to the claimant ID of the current book, and I return. Okay, so what you see is that this actually allows you to think more logically. You're talking about the claimant ID of, you know, you can think of this dot operator as saying claimant ID of current book, claimed book accession number of current patron, right hand side of the left hand side for the dot operator. Right? And that's what we want to say. Claimant ID of the current book should be set to unique ID of current patron. So this is exactly how we write it in C++. Okay, and how do we return a book? So, you know, we just see if the number of books checked out for the current patron is greater than 0, then we decrement it and set the checkout status of the book to false. And here is a very strange situation. So suppose a patron has come to return a book, but the number of books checked out for this patron is already 0, which means this patron had not really checked out any book, but the patron is trying to return a book, right? So that's a funny situation. So we say that, well, are you trying to return somebody else's book, right? And, you know, so this strange scenario happens if a patron tries to return a book checked out by somebody else. And why does this happen? That is because we did not keep track of all the information that we could have remembered in our objects, right? So in particular, when a patron checks out a book, the ID of the patron was not recorded with the book. We simply said the book has been checked out. The checkout status was set to true, but we did not record who has checked out this book, right? And similarly, the accession numbers of the books checked out by a patron were not recorded with the patron. And that is why if a patron comes to return a book, I don't have any way to check whether this patron had herself checked out that book, right? So if we keep track of the above information, we could sort of, you know, avoid these strange situations. And so, you know, presumably we want to add a borrower ID member to the book structure so that when a book is borrowed by somebody, we can put the ID of that borrower there. And we want to, since a patron is allowed to check out 3 books, so we want to have an array of size 3 containing the borrowed book's accessions numbers. But the point is that now that we have defined our structure, written some program for checking out, claiming, returning, how do we change things now? Do we go back to square one and redesign everything? So this is once again where object-oriented modular programming is actually very useful. We have already encapsulated things, saying that a patron has these things, a book has these things. We want to add additional things there. So we can go ahead and add those additional things. For example, in the book structure, I can add this additional member. In the patron structure, I can add this additional member. And whatever I had defined earlier, library patrons is an array of size 200 of patrons. That continues to stay as it is, except that each object here now also has this additional member. So no change is needed in this part of the code where I was declaring a library of 1,000 books. It's just that every book an additional member because I've sort of augmented or changed the definition of the structure. And I could initialize those to minus one. And then I could go back to the functions that I wrote. And you know, when I was accessing checkout status of current book, those things can stay just as they were, because the members that I had seen earlier are still there. I have added some additional members. So I could simply write some code which operates on those additional members. The previous code can still stay as it is. Okay? So for example, here, when I'm checking out a book, I have to iterate through this borrowed accession number member array of current pattern. And whenever I see an empty entry there, which means borrowed accession number I is minus one, then I'm going to store the accession number of the current book that is being checked out over there and break, right? And similarly, I will store the ID of the current pattern in the borrower ID of the book. So I'm just adding this additional piece of code. The other code that was there is untouched, right? So this is incremental software development, that you think of some feature later on, do something such that you don't need to change most of the code that you have written. You just write the code that takes care of this additional functionality. And similarly, you know, so in the slides it is given, you can similarly change claim book. This was the earlier code. Now that becomes a special case. You have to check whether the borrower ID is the same as the unique ID, and then you can print out some message. So this is additional code that I incrementally write to improve the functionality. And similarly for returning the book. So this main part which was there stays as it is, but there's some additional part that comes in. Okay? So okay, that's the summary. So we've actually covered 6 lectures in 48 minutes. Okay? And I hope all of you understood. I did not speed through the lectures. Okay, are there any doubts about it? No? No doubts? Okay. Okay, let's go to the quiz then. Okay, so that's the first question. Consider the structure definition. Struct x, int y, char z. So if var is a variable of type struct x, the member y of var is accessed in which of the following ways? Next question. Which of the following is or are true of structures defined in C++? All members must have the same data type, cannot have arrays as members, cannot have two different members with the same name, cannot have more than 1,000 members. So consider the structure definition, struct x, int y, z. So y and z are both members of type int. So if we declare and initialize a variable myvar as x myvar equals 0, 1, the initialized values of the members of myvar are which of the following options? Right? So this option means y is initialized to 0, z is initialized to 0, y is initialized to 1, z is initialized to 0, and so on. Suppose x and y are two variables of struct mystruct. The assignment statement x is assigned y is what? It's an illegal statement in C++, makes the addresses of x and y the same, copies values of all members of y to corresponding members of x, and none of the above. So suppose struct x is a structure with an integer member named y. So the declaration x abc 10 declares an array of objects of type struct x. So which of the following accesses the member y of the fifth element of the array? Member y of the fifth element of the array. Which of the four given four options accesses the member y of the fifth element of the array? So let's quickly go through these and see what the right answers are. So here, I believe all of you have figured out var dot y is the right answer, accessing member y of the variable var. So here, members need not be of the same data type. It can have arrays as members. But you cannot have two different members with the same name, because when you put dot and the name, there would be ambiguity about which member you're referring to. And it can certainly have more than 1,000 members. There are no restrictions on number of members, right? So here the initialization, y will get initialized to 0, z will get initialized to 1. This is certainly not an illegal statement. it will simply copy the values of all members of Y to the corresponding members of X. And here, I am accessing the fifth element of the array, so it is ABC5. So this is the fifth element, and then you access the member Y of it. Okay? Okay, good. Now let's start the practice question. Okay, so how many of you know about binary trees? Nobody? Good. So we are on the level playing field then. Oh, you know, some of you know about binary trees. Okay. So let's see if this question becomes easy. So a binary tree, so as you just saw in that library example, right, when we are trying to design something which is a bit more complex, we would want to group things together, we would try to represent relations between objects and so on. So a binary tree is a data structure, whereby a data structure we really mean a way of representing information, in which data items are related by a parent-child relationship, okay, satisfying certain conditions, right? So it's a way of representing information such that the data items have a parent-child relationship and there are some conditions that are satisfied in this parent-child relationship. So what are the conditions? That there is a designated data item which we will call the root, which has no parent. It has no parent data items. Every other data item has one unique parent data item. Okay, so there is one guy who doesn't have any parent. Everybody else has exactly one unique parent. Every data item has at most two children data items. So remember, there's a parent-child relationship. So every data item has one unique parent. It has two children data items. These two children are also unique. They are not the same. And there are designated data items called leaves, which do not have any children further than them. Okay? So here is a representation of a binary tree. So that yellow thing there is the root data item. And then these two blue things are what we will call, these are the two children of that root data item. So we will call this the left child of the root and the right child of the root. This arrow does not denote any pointer or anything. It's just denoting the relation that this is related to this through the, this is the parent, this is the left child, this is the parent, this is the right child. And I've sort of drawn the arrow there to sort of make this very explicit visually. Okay? And then of course, this in turn has two children, one left, one right. That has further children. And look at these guys, they don't have any children. So they are the leaves. And you know, let's call this A, then everything that comes below A, the children of A and their children and so on are all called descendants of A. So in this case, there are four descendants of A. Similarly, there is one descendant of B. Of course, everything is a descendant of the root. Is this clear? So each box here is like some data item. The arrows are some kind of relations between the data items. And the relation is sort of organized in this way. So this is what we called a binary tree. Okay? Is this clear? Okay, good. So now consider the following structure definition. Struct tree node, int value, int left child, and int right child. Okay, so we can think of an object of type tree node. You can visually think of it as having three members. One is the value, one is the left child, one is the right child. All of these three are integer valued members. Okay, there's a structure of the type that we just studied. Is this clear? I'd request you to just note this down because I have to move to the next slide where we will need this. Okay, just the definition of the structure. Struct tree node, int value, int left child, and int right child. So now we want to use an array A of objects of type struct tree node. Right? So that was our struct tree node. So this was kind of an object of type tree node. So we want to use an array of these objects. And let's call that array A. So we want to use an array A of objects of type struct tree node to represent a binary tree. So how are we going to represent it? We will say A0. Remember, every object has these three members. The top one is the value, this is the left child, this is the right child, right? So we will say A0 is the root. Okay, that's a data item, that's the root. and we'll see what value the left child member has. If the left child member has value 3, we will say A3 is the left child of A0. If the right child member has the value 7, we will say A7 is the right child of A0. Is that clear? So that's what these arrows are representing. So if this is 3, it means the left child is A3, the right child is A7. A3 itself has a value. It has its own left child, has its own right child. If I have -1 for the right child, of course, -1 cannot be an index in an array. It just means that there is no right child for this data item, right? And similarly, A7 is the right child of the root. It has no left child. It has a right child, which is A9. So I hope you'll agree that I can actually represent a binary tree by just filling in the values of left child and right child. You are now given an array A of size 100 of tree node objects such that the values are already sorted. So A0 dot value is less than or equal to A1 dot value is less than or equal to A99 dot value. Okay? And the values of left child and right child of every element is set to -1. Right? So basically these are like individual data items without any parent-child relationship. Okay? However, their values are all sorted, and it is sorted in this order. Okay? So you are required to write a function. We will call that function heapify, which will take that array of tree nodes, right? An array of tree nodes is of type tree node pointer. That array name is of type tree node pointer. We saw it in last class. So this function will take that array of tree nodes and it will fill in the values of left child and right child members of all elements such that using those left child and right child members, I'm going to get a binary tree, and in that binary tree, the value of every node is less than or equal to the value of all its descendants. Right? You remember what a descendant was? Children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and so on. Right? So I want the value of a node to be less than or equal to the value of everything below that node. And we want you to fill in the values of left child and right child appropriately. The value fields are already sorted. A0 dot value is less than or equal to A1 dot value is, and so on. So you can assume that the root is A0. And of course, the absence of children is indicated by putting -1 in the corresponding member. Is the question clear? You are given an array of tree node objects. Each tree node object is like this. Right? So this is an array of size 5 of tree node objects. The value fields are already sorted. For example, this could be 10, 11, 14, 17, 19. Okay? These are all initialized to -1. So you will be given this array. This is the array A, which will be passed to your function, heapify. Your function is supposed to go ahead and fill in values in these places. The left child and right child members of all objects in that array. Such that, so for example, right, so this is A0, this is A1, this is A2, this is A3, and this is A4. So suppose I filled in 2 here and I filled in 1 there. Suppose, just for the heck of it. Okay? So what would this mean? It would mean that A0 is the root, because we have said that assume that the root is A0. And its left child is A2, its right child is A1. So its left child is A2. And its right child is A1. Right? What is the value for A0? 10. What is the value for A2? So actually, let me not put 1 here. Let's say 4. Suppose I put in that over there, right? So A0 is the root, its value is 10, left child is A2, value is 14, right child is A4, value is 19. Right? So if I have filled in 2 and 4 here. And now let us say for A2, I fill in this as 1 and I keep that as minus 1. So then what would this mean? That its left child is A1. And what is the value of A1? 11. Now you see that A2 has value 14, but its child has value 11. So that violates the condition that we have there, that the value of a node must be less than or equal to the value of its descendants. This is a descendant of that, but its value is less than or equal to, it's strictly less than the value of that, right? But what we needed is the value of a node should be less than or equal to the value of its descendants. That is violated here. So if you fill in like this, then it is not a correct answer, right? What could be a correct answer? For example, if I had put A1 over here, like I had done first, so then A1 is 11, right? And let us say I put minus 1 here, and here I put 4 and 3, let us say, right? So this would be A4, and that would be A3. What is the value of A4? A4 is 9. Value of A3 is 17, and these could be minus 1. Right? So now the value of every node is less than or equal to the values of its descendants. 11 is less than or equal to 19, 11 is less than or equal to 17, 10 is less than or equal to the value of everything, all its descendants, and so on. Is this clear what we want? Clear, everybody, what we want? So now that is what we want you to do. So you're going to be given an array A of size 100, where A0 dot value till A99 dot value are all sorted in increasing order. All the left and right childs are initialized to minus 1. You have to fill in the values of left child and right child members such that value of a node is less than or equal to value of all its descendants. So there is a trivial solution to this, which is a correct solution. So please don't think very complicated. There is a very, very simple solution to this. Okay, at least the question that we have asked has a very, very simple solution. And if all of you come up with that solution, I'm going to complicate that question a little bit more. Okay, so here is Saran's solution. It's a perfectly correct solution. So he's saying he'll just keep the right child's minus 1. So there are no right children, right? And he's just setting the left child of A0 to be A1, the left child of A1 to be A2, left child of A2 to be A3, and so on. Right? So the array is already sorted. So obviously everything, I mean, the only descendants of A0 are A1 through A99. The only descendants of A1 are A2 through A99. So of course that condition is trivially met, right?
So you can see that Saran's solution requires 100 generations to accommodate all these 100 children. If you want to accommodate all these children in the least number of generations, basically, if you look at this tree, it has a height of 100. If I want to minimize the height, so that is the minimal number of generations, sort of. The number of descendants may be more. What could be this? I think that is the next one.
You know, so basically here, what in Saransh's solution, there is no node with two children, right? So now if I tell you that you have to maximize the number of nodes with two children, which is the same as minimizing this height of the tree, right? So if you look at this solution, that is the root, there will be exactly one leaf, which will be A99. And to come from the root to the leaf, you'll have to cross whatever, 99 elements. So now the next version of the question is, it's exactly the same thing, But now you have to have as many nodes with two children as possible. That will automatically reduce the height of the tree. Is the question clear? So for example, this tree did not have one child per node. There were several nodes with two children, right? And in fact, this tree is such that with five elements, there are two nodes having two children, and this is the maximum that you can do. Maximum number of nodes with two children has to be two. The strategy is something like this. So A0 is the root, and then he wants to put A1 and A2, then A3, A4, A5, A6, and so on. So clearly this will maximize the number of nodes with two children. He's always giving two children to nodes as long as it is possible. And so he has to come up with this numbering scheme such that the left child of 0 is 1, the right child of 0 is 2, the left child of 1 is 3, the right child of 1 is 4, and so on. So if you just see this, eyeball this for a few minutes, you should be able to see a pattern here. So Saransh has of course done it in the following way. He has a loop here where he's saying while k is less than or equal to 99, so he starts off with int I is 0, and in the loop he's going to set ai dot left child and ai dot right child and increment I. Okay? And he's just going in this order. So he starts off by setting k to 1, and he associates the next number. So ai dot left child is k plus plus, ai dot right child is k plus plus. So it's like saying 0, 1, 2, and then you take 1, that is 3, 4, you take 2, that is 4, 6, and you take 3, that will be 7, 8, you take 4, that will be 9, 10, and so on. Right? And then of course he is doing some checks if k is not equal to 100. So basically you don't want to put values here which are greater than 99. Right? So if they are becoming greater than 99, you put minus 1 there, which means that you have exhausted all the nodes after assigning two children. So another way of doing this is what Govind has done, which is basically, if you see the pattern here, the left child of the ith node is 2i plus 1, the right child of the ith node is 2i plus 2. Right? And that is exactly what you'll get from here also. From this loop also, you'll get exactly that same thing. So that's a very simple solution. If you look at it, so what we'll get at the end of it is a tree like this. And as you can see, every node in the tree must have a value, and it must have some information about who is the left child and who is the right child. And that is most conveniently done using a structure. Right? You want to store a value, and you also want to store information about who is the left child and who is the right child. So that's most conveniently done using a structure. So therefore, you can now represent all kinds of different relations between data items. Here it was a binary tree relation. You can represent different kinds of data relations between data items using structures. You can use specific members of the structures to represent information about the relation. And as I just said, that this kind of a data structure is also called a heap. And in this case, of course, the values of A were all sorted to begin with. So we are basically getting this heap quite easily. You have studied about selection sort and merge sort. So there is another sorting technique called heap sort, which basically tries to build a heap out from unsorted elements. And the process of trying to build a heap is to basically build a binary tree which satisfies that property. Value of every node is less than or equal to value of all its descendants. And if you can ensure that for the whole thing, then you have the array sorted. Okay. So we'll stop here.